Thank you, Hugh. It's great to be with you today and excited about the opportunity. I confess to being a bit overwhelmed and amazed at the response. I don't want to take our time lightly today. There are several here who are participating as individuals. We also have some others where staff of the church are signed on together, and some where even the entire group is in the room together. I think our collective interest here is because the concept of disciple making and of putting systems in place to make disciples as well as manage all aspects of the church work are not conventional to apostolic thinking. In so much of the church world, we tend to want to feel and passion and kind of fantastic our way, if you please, into accomplishments. The truth of the matter is that nothing significant for God gets done by flash and dash. It is consistency, it's repetition, it's establishing processes and systems and doing those things, replicating them over and over. So what we're going to talk about today is not flashy revival. It's not revival that gets written up in periodicals. But it's something that is accessible to each person here, regardless of whether one is an introvert or an extrovert, or whether they have the charisma that would cause people to just kind of follow you along, or whatever the case would be. The things that we're going to talk about can be applied by any person in virtually any church setting, regardless of the age or size of the congregation that you're working with. We're going to try to accomplish a couple of things. First is give you some processes to think about for caring for new converts. And secondly, as part of this process, to introduce you to a tool that North American Missions has a vested interest in you putting to use in your local church. That tool has been the key to putting every aspect of this webinar together. The tool is something, actually, it's known as Finish Line Planner, and it was initially created to manage North American Missions, but it's now being used in churches, both large and small, all over the world, as well as missions causes, and in some instances, corporate causes, to get things meaningful done for the local church. Now, in Acts chapter 2, they baptized people. But baptism was not the end all, nor should it be now. I congratulate you if you baptized 500 people last year, but the question becomes, how many of those people have been retained, and is the church actually growing? Baptism is obviously part of the process, but if I could use a manufacturing analogy, the end product of the work of the church is that we create disciples of Jesus Christ. So I think at times our measures are wrong because we celebrate a revival where 500 or 1,000 get the Holy Ghost. I actually have a friend who back in the 70s had a significant revival where in a number of months 1,000 people received the Holy Ghost. And 1 year later, he asked his congregation, significant size church, how many of you here tonight are people who were converted in that 1,000-soul revival? Much to his dismay, one person stood who had received the Holy Ghost in that revival. It's unfortunate if churches have a great harvest and a lot of people converted, but the church stays the same size year after year. In reality, we're not being successful, regardless of who writes up the incredible revival we had or how many Twitter posts or Facebook posts there are about it. We're not being very effective. In Acts chapter 6, verse 2 through 6, the early church makes a major step because they begin to organize themselves to serve the constituency that they're now winning. Of course, this is the establishment of those who we would call the deacons or the diaconate, they took responsibility that formerly the apostles were taking care of. It's kind of interesting that immediately after there is this establishing of a system to take care of significant things in the early church, that the Bible says in Acts chapter 6, verse 7, that the disciples are multiplied. Okay, so you have the apostles, you have the book of Acts, church's birth, you have people being added to the church, people being baptized, and then you have a structure created to care for the people who are in the church and the people who are being added to the church. Then there is this multiplication. So I'm just going to go on record and just be locked in here that if you don't have a structure to take care of the babies in your church, you're not going to keep very many of them. Having a structure is vital. So are you happy to report that 40 received the Holy Ghost last year? Or do you want to do the hard work, behind the scenes work, the work that's not very fluffy, to develop those converts into disciples who become your Sunday school teachers and your praise leaders, and eventually through those folk, you multiply the effectiveness of the church? I think that your being here on this Saturday afternoon, at least Saturday afternoon in the Midwest, shows your passion is something more than simply making converts. You want to develop and to grow people. So let me just talk about the how and why of new convert care. If you go back and look at the beginning of the 20th century, even here in North America, over 50% of all natural births died in infancy. Today, significantly fewer than 10% of all infants born in North America die. Birth process hadn't changed. Reproduction hasn't changed. So what has changed? The thing that's different is the care of new babies. The how and why of taking care of infants is very different today than it was all of those decades ago. If we can apply that to the New Testament church, Jesus did not simply call the 12. He specifically trained them. As a matter of fact, I really recommend that you read the book, the author's name escapes me, The Training of the 12, because it talks about all that Jesus put into these 12 men that eventually allowed them to become what he intended them to become. Okay, let's move that into our own thinking. People are being called, they're coming into the church, but are we training them? What about my process? What about my thought process needs to change? Whenever you look out at the congregation tomorrow, we all see this group of people that are sitting in front of us. But the truth of the matter is that not every person in that room is equal. Not every person there is the same as the person sitting beside them. The knowledge base is different. The experience with God is different. The ability to even find the text you're going to be preaching from may be very, very different. So the new convert who is sitting beside this mature saint of God is not just someone who is newer to the church than the other person is. The new convert is a baby. I mean, get that in your mind. They are a spiritual baby, and a spiritual baby can't survive on the finest of steak, no matter how good that steak may be. So get it in your mind. My great preaching, my great sermon that may very clearly communicate who Melchizedek is, probably is not going to hit the target for the spiritual baby who is in that church. That's very important to look at that person and see them for what they are. They're a spiritual baby. And as a baby, babies get primary attention. They get primary attention from parents, from grandparents, and from older siblings. They're brothers and sisters. And as a church leader, if you're going to grow the church, you have to put the focus on maturing your new spiritual babies. So with that in mind, what does it take to maximize the growth of these new babies as they come in? I think it'd be wise to just sit down and ask yourself, what are the issues that a new convert faces? What are the questions that they are going to have about the church? And then what are the challenges that they are going to have to overcome in order to survive? And then beyond that, you got issues, questions, challenges. What do we do to address those issues, those questions, and those challenges? What is my behavior? I don't just want to research what those issues, questions, and challenges are. I want to know something that I can do that may help us to be more effective. If we can do this, it will establish an effective process, a system for taking care of your spiritual babies, and you begin working toward thinking of what do I need from myself, and if you're a little further down the road, not just planning a church, what do I need from a team of people to help me pull this off? Lyndon Johnson became president, was president in a challenging time. In a news conference in 1964, President Johnson said, "There are no problems we cannot solve together, and very few we can solve by ourselves." Think about that just a minute. No problem or challenge here that we can't solve together, and very few that we can solve by ourselves. What can we do collectively? What can you do at your local church level collectively? One of the things that I've done through the years has just been a collector of ideas, and I've benefited from latching hold to ideas and workable concepts from every imaginable direction. So let's talk about an idea that can affect not only your new convert care, but every aspect of managing the church. Okay, now, with your new converts, have you struggled ever with the time and energy it takes to follow up on a newcomer, as well as the numerous other things the church needs? I find myself, I'm working these days with a church in Springfield, Missouri, and I find myself trying to figure out, how do we get all of this done? How do we get it in? And I think that's a common challenge. How do we get it done, and how do we put the priority on the things that really matter? And by the way, babies are a priority. Spiritual babies are a priority for you in growing a church. Okay, so we're struggling. We have time and energy issues. There's not enough hours in the day. So take that a step further. Do we have other people, no matter how young the church may be, to assist with the responsibility of getting things done to advance both the church and then taking care of these spiritual babies? It's not enough to have a good idea. I learned that in the corporate world, as well as pastoring a growing church. I discovered that this vision, idea, plan wasn't enough. You have to have the will to execute, if you please. And that the devil in getting these things done that matter is in the details. I don't know. You may not be like me at all. I have some friends who seem to never lose anything from their memory, but details tend to not linger in my mind. So I need help with making sure all of these things get done. In our assessment some years ago of what was needed for new converts, and I'm going to touch on these real quick. Each of these is its own unique project, if you please. But okay, a person comes tomorrow and they get baptized. What happens with that person? Well, In an ideal situation, that new convert meets with a trained altar counselor. And that altar counselor is going to begin that person's journey as a new convert, going to share with them some specifics about the church and when classes meet and all of that kind of stuff. Now, if you're the pastor of a home missions church, you probably get to be the altar counselor too. As I go through all of this, just imagine the different responsibilities that are here and how much better it would be and is if someone has some help, even if that person who is helping is themselves relatively a newcomer to your church. Okay, the second thing that we discovered is that having a follow-up contact with a telephone friend who was specifically assigned to this new believer was a great asset. A letter that would go from the pastor to this person's spiritual parent. Spiritual parent would be the person who had brought them to church or who had taught them a home Bible study or who was somehow connected to them very closely. In these early days, we're going to specifically have the task of someone inviting them to become part of a home Bible study if they're not already part of one. Okay? Now, the new convert receives a letter from the pastor. New convert is going to get this letter, but that's not going to be the last letter they would get from me as pastor. They're going to get 10 or 12 additional letters that basically are home Bible studies under the guise of a letter from the pastor. This new convert is going to be part of a process of welcoming the new believer on the last Sunday of each month, and not just the home Bible study now. We're going to get them into a Christian development class, or in your instance, you might call it a orientation class or a new convert class, whatever the case would be, but it's going to be teaching and training that is specific to them as spiritual babies. Okay, after the new converts complete each of these different levels, and your level may be a month or it may be 10 weeks or 12. We used a 10-week series called Take Root that I've written myself, and then an 11-week series that follow up on that called Bear Fruit, and then the third component was something called Fitly Frame. Each of them training these people to become something more than they were, advancing them and maturing them. But for each of the levels, we had a graduation. And the graduation was a big celebration. We'd clap and give a little gift and a certificate. So again, what I'm trying to portray here is that this system, this was not based on the whim of emotion. This system wasn't complicated. But there was a lot of detail to it. After they completed the third level with Fitly Frame, we wanted that person to be involved in a defined role in the church. We also wanted the new believer to be assigned to someone who would have fellowship with them each month for 1 year. And of course, we did events like having these new believers come to our house as the pastor. One of my responsibilities as pastor was to meet with a discipleship director for 30 minutes to an hour each week, just getting an update on all of these new folks. And at that time, the discipleship director would give me a confidential report about how all these folks are doing and the ones we hadn't been seeing at church. And you know, again, what I'm trying to get into your mind is that this, what I'm describing, really works at keeping new people. But now it is work. And all that we can do to simplify our work and to make our work easier is much, much to our benefit. I guess it was 20 plus years ago working in the corporate world, I discovered that we could plan our big pictures, but we had to develop details. We had to develop step-by-step processes if we were going to get the big picture accomplished. In the business world, they call those step-by-step procedures a Gantt chart. actually for our church for years, we would use handwritten Gantt charts for things like a new convert social. Every time we did a new convert social, you had to recreate this entire Gantt chart for this particular project. They had to just be rebuilt. When I became the director of North American Missions, with all of the myriad of details that we dealt with, I thought, wow, this is going right back to the whole handwritten Gantt chart thing. And we did that for a while. But it being the computer age, I began to look for something that would simplify our work. And I looked at things like Microsoft Project and some others, and they were just overkill for what we were trying to do and didn't interface well with the church work or what I wanted for the office. So we got busy developing something, and of course, Travis Miller was the secretary of our division then. He had a personal acquaintance with Hugh Plappert, who had been working with some similar things and developing resources to help get things accomplished in the corporate world. And from it, there was this creation of the tool that is known as Finish Line Planner. Finish Line Planner is a tool that helps and can help all of the things that I've described having to do with taking care of our new converts could be much more easily managed and overseen with a tool like Finish Line Planner. And, of course, this is applicable specifically to the church, but there are people who are using this tool, this specific tool, in all kind of other places, construction, software development, and that sort of thing. Today, we're talking about the work of the church and being effective with taking care of new converts. What we want to have happen with new converts is not going to just happen. There is a system for taking care of spiritual babies. So, okay, great question that's asked. What point do we consider a person a new convert? And I think the answer to that varies, but for us, it was generally a person who had been baptized or a person who had received the Holy Ghost. Now, I say generally because that was the norm. However, there were times when we would have people who would come to church for weeks, and in some instances, months and months and months. And it was obvious that this was their church. They were being assimilated into the church. They wanted to participate in the church. They were giving. This was their church home. I was going to preach their funeral. They were making some progress in repentance, but they had not yet made a decision to be baptized. We would at times include those, but it was by invitation. As a matter of fact, I think it's very important that all of your welcome be by invitation. Great, great question. You're going to have to be flexible with it, but as a rule, baptized or receive the Holy Ghost. Okay, the question is asked, which programs do I recommend for use for teaching classes to new converts? Well, I'm incredibly biased toward the classes Take Root and Bear Fruit, and I'm biased toward those because I created them and wrote them and had 15 years of using them in our local church. There's a multiplicity of other great tools. With North American Missions, we have something that Brother Yance developed, the late Brother Yance developed quite a number of years ago. It's still very, very good material. I will say this, that in my own pastoral experience, as I was leaving Truth Tabernacle in Springfield, Missouri, I realized that we were missing a boat, and we were moving people too quickly into doctrine. And so in the future, I'll use something for several weeks with newcomers to teach them some basic Christian disciplines, like how to read the Bible for themselves in a way to benefit, how to pray, Very simple, using the little prayer clock, not for people to pray an hour, but for if I can get them to pray 2 minutes in each of those, they've prayed 30 minutes almost, 25 minutes. So, again, I think it's important to know where your people are at. There's great stuff out there, but again, I do like take root and bear fruit. I would say I think it's very important that you do be very careful in maintaining that database, have constant contact with your newcomers. It doesn't just need to be you're waiting on them to come to church. You may want to send them a reminder note using text message or the Facebook Messenger app or Twitter or whatever. Don't forget about the class we're having. I'm working, as I mentioned earlier, with a group in back again in Springfield, Missouri. And one of the things that we do is on our visitor card, we ask them, can we get your cell phone number? Is it okay if the pastor uses this number to contact you by text message? And do you know, to this point, every single person who has sent their guest card back in has said yes. And then we, of course, ask, do you have a Facebook or Instagram or Twitter account? Can we connect with you there? Again, to this point, if they've had the accounts, it's yes. These are great opportunities, but now if we're talking about a project to consistently connect with them, we need to systematize that. It doesn't need to be, and right now, I'll be honest, I'm just doing it on the whim of the moment. But it really needs a system attached to it and will be much, much more effective. Doing follow-up visitation and how that could be done. Okay, the question is asked, what process do we suggest on some things that I have used for follow-up after a person makes their first visit? The thing that we always try to do is communicate with them by letter. Now, in the day of social media, today I would be using text message and I would be using some other things, but I would send them a personal handwritten card through the mail having invited them and welcomed them. The other thing that I would encourage you to think about in regard to visitors is we tend to give a lot of attention to first-time visitors, but there is a huge amount of value to giving attention to your second-time visitor. Okay, a person who visits your church for the second time knows what they're getting into. They've heard you preach. They know that this is a Pentecostal church, and they're back. Okay. The fact that they're back means that there's a certain comfort zone and an openness to be at this church. Now, my personal approach as a pastor was that if you come the third time, you're mine. You don't know it yet, and of course, sometimes it didn't materialize that way, but it's just a matter of days before you're part of this church. Matter of fact, I tease people who make the third visit that we're going to put you on the trustee board. Having that systematic approach for second-time visitors is very, very important. Brother McKee, Rob McKee, just outside of Houston, is doing an incredible job with this second-time visitor response. He gives them a packet of sermons. They get to choose whether it's about loneliness or overcoming depression or whatever the case would be, things that are kind of relevant to their lives. They get to pick one of those groups. And it's worked very, very well for them. So be creative in that. Things that are kind of relevant to their lives, they get to pick one of those groups. And it's worked very, very well for them. So be creative in that. Okay, great question. Do we teach take root and bear fruit in small groups or large church congregation? I've done this both ways. My preference by far is small group. And here's why. Small group allows interaction. As the teacher, whether it's in the large group or the small, I have the students do all of the Bible reading. If you have six or eight people sitting around a room, around a table, Many of those who would not raise their hand as being willing to read in a group of 50 or 60 are willing to read in that smaller group. So it becomes very participatory. I also want them constantly to be free to ask questions. I think that the small group lends itself to the whole coffee and donuts kind of thing, and we get to laugh together. Those new converts who are in that smaller group learn a lot about each other. I want you to think about the amount of time. Now, with good ground, we're talking 8 weeks. Take root for us was 10 weeks, 11 weeks in bear fruit, and then 7 weeks in fitly frame. So you're looking at all, by the time you have a few weekends where you just can't do it because it's a holiday weekend or some special event or somebody's sick who's supposed to teach the class, you will have these people in a discipleship class for a year. Okay, so they're going to get pretty connected with each other. Now, when I talk about that real often, people say, a year? You mean, my God, a year? Yeah, I mean a year. You can't rush what we're trying to do. There's no shortcutting where people are coming from to where we want them to become significant people for God. So so this takes some time. I prefer the small group, but I have done it in larger groups as well. You need to keep a database, and I say that, and I'm not doing a very good job with it. I also think that you really do need to keep attendance. If your church is even, very, very small, very young church. And here's why. It's easy for people to slip through the cracks, even in a church of 70 or 80, and you just don't realize that out of the last month, these folks have not been here 3 weekends. You've got a lot on your mind. But if you have a process, again, we go back to systems. If you get a system established that red flags when somebody misses 2 out of 3 weekends, then how can we get hold of discipleship material? My personal website is Truth Publications, truth-publications.com. I'd be glad to do all that we can to accomplish that. You can also order these from PPH as well. And number of places that you can order the material. Great question. When do you know that a new convert is ready to take a church position? Let me answer it this way. I'm very, very hesitant to give out positions. I am not hesitant to put people to work. New converts, the principle is this: you use them or you will lose them. So you have to find ways to involve them and put them to work. And the sooner you can do that, the better. Now, when I say I'm very keen on putting them to work, let me use Lori again as an example. I could see her, she's just graduated with an associate's degree from a college. I could see Lori as being the person who I would assign to take attendance during our weekend services. Okay? Does she have all of the lifestyle stuff figured out? Probably not. Can she explain the oneness of God? Probably not. Is she ready to do what I'm asking her to do? Probably. Okay? So I've given her this task. I say, okay, Lori, for the month of April, would you keep an attendance record? And I'm going to make this easy. I'm going to give you a list of everybody we expect to be here. And what I want you to do is just check the ones who were here. Okay? I'm not going to give her that as a permanent job because I want to determine if she's going to be faithful in that. If she's not faithful in doing that, then I don't want her as the Sunday school secretary. Okay, if that makes sense. But get people participating. And you'll have people participating as new converts who, when you get into it, you realize Wow, they really don't have some lifestyle stuff down. You work that through with time. Time takes care of a lot of that stuff. You just use them. Again, you're not going to put them leading the choir or over your Sunday school department, but you want them to participate. Now, let me drop this in. The first holiness standard that I think you should apply for your new converts is pre-service prayer. If they can't make it to pre-service prayer, then you can't use them for anything else much, because that's real easy to understand. We're going to be a praying church, and we expect those who are involved to be praying people. Okay? If a person can't do that and can't apply themselves to that, then they're probably not going to be very effective in any role of ministry in the church. So I think that's a great place to apply it.